Now we got it. I didn't have it on.
Good evening, everyone. Again, my name is Mike Korbel, and I want to thank the College of Complexes for inviting us here this evening to speak. And I'm hoping that we can keep a spirit of open-mindedness and intellectual debate. And though I understand everyone in the room does not have the same ideology, we're just going to philosophize for a while. Just to introduce myself, I actually am from South Elgin, Illinois. I am a businessman, but I've been a libertarian for the last 4 years.
Yeah.
I was not always a libertarian, but I had an awakening some time ago, and I like to read, and I like to watch movies and videos, and this philosophy won me over. So let me ask a question. For those of you who don't know if you are a libertarian or not, if you've ever been in a room where all your conservative friends think you're a liberal, and all your liberal friends think you're a conservative, you're probably a libertarian. So you probably think of about a million and one reasons why you probably would either vote for Trump or vote for, what was that, that nasty woman? I'm not gonna point fingers at same names here, I'm just going along with the joke here, but you can either support Clinton or you can support Donald Trump, but there is a third candidate. His name is Gary Johnson. He's part of the Libertarian Party. So hopefully after tonight, you'll understand about our ideology and why we are supporting the candidates we do. So let me just get a show of hands. Who here knows a little something about libertarianism? Okay, so this might be preaching to the choir. It might not be. But this is not the gospel of libertarianism. I'm not going to sit there and recite the party platform, but this is my interpretation of what our ideology is, and I hope that the other speakers will share their views as well. So, going forward.
You got it?
There we go. All right, so what is libertarianism? Well, first and foremost, it's a philosophical viewpoint. Okay, more than just a political party, it's actually a philosophy. And with comes philosophy, obviously, it comes discussion, and everyone has a different interpretation of philosophy. You'll notice that in a room full of libertarians, you'll probably get about a million and one different viewpoints about any given issue. But hopefully, we'll condense all that tonight and get a main point of what the generalized theme is, and that's what my job is. It says on the PowerPoint, it's a systematic viewpoint of human society and the relationship of citizens to one another, and especially the relationship of citizens to their governments. So it's not necessarily a lifestyle, it's more of a governmental viewpoint. And so you'll get people who are believers in higher authority and religious people, and you'll get people who are not believers within libertarianism, but again, it's mainly about a governmental type of philosophy. Because it is a philosophy, there really is no root of this philosophy, although many people, in my estimation, can trace our thinking back to pre-revolutionary America. Some of the famous philosophers, such as John Locke, who had his natural law theory, and he believed in life, liberty, and property. If you know a little bit about John Locke, he lived in the 1600s. Okay, it says rights are derived from a higher authority and not from government. So the basic natural rights in that ideology is you have a right to life, you have a right to liberty, and you have a right to own your own property. Some of the thinkers that came after John Locke, of course, Adam Smith, if you're familiar with his book, The Wealth of Nations, he talked a lot about how economies are run and what actually drives them. And of course, Thomas Hobbes also had an ideology and a philosophy about social contract and the consent of the governed. In other words, in a civil society, those who are going to have authority over you have to actually have that consent of those who are going to be governed over. And that inspired a lot of the thinkers, such as Thomas Jefferson and our founding fathers, James Madison. We know in 1776, of course, the Declaration of Independence. And of course, a few years after that, James Madison was largely responsible for penning the Constitution of the United States. So I'm here to talk more about the American side of libertarianism than it is a worldview, but my belief is that these two gentlemen, particularly in America, have kept that theme, and that's what we want to be sharing about today. So one of the things that I've noticed in this country particularly is this lost concept of what the Founding Fathers really actually had when they designed the United States of America. is this idea of federalism versus nationalism. Okay, federalism, I'll write it, it says power is shared equally between individual states and the central government. For example, each state will have their own constitution, each state will have its own laws, but they don't have the right to have foreign decisions made. They don't have the right to enter treaties with other foreign countries. They don't have the right to declare war or anything like that. That goes to the centralized authority. However, this country has dramatically changed from individual sovereign states to a more nationalistic viewpoint, and most of the decisions now, instead of being actually decided on a local level, are decided in Washington, D.C., and that's where this great debate comes as to who will be a better president, who's going to run the whole country. Instead of what the founders originally wanted was every state will have it their own way they want to actually run their individual laws and societies. So as you can see in a discussion about government, if you think that problems, the government creates problems, just wait till you see the solutions of government. We really believe that government is a majority of the problems that are facing this country, even on the individual level. And because libertarians believe in that root word of liberty, we're going to have a discussion about what is liberty. How do you define what liberty really is? I guess it's different in every single person who thinks about that, but this is what libertarians believe. Government is a great fiction through which everybody endeavors to live at the expense of everyone else. Famous author Frederick Bastiat wrote that. I believe it was in his book, The Law, that was written in the 1800s. Libertarians believe in limited, non-restricted government, whereby whatever is legally allowed for individuals or unallowable between individuals is also allowed or not allowed by government. So in other words, whatever you have the right to do as a human being, as an individual person, the government should have the same exact rights. And that's really what libertarianism is all about. And you can see the Gadsden flag down there, don't tread on me. So there is a distinction between libertarians and the Libertarian Party. Libertarians, basically the ideology has been around for hundreds of years, as I just previously mentioned. The Libertarian Party was actually formed in 1971. And it was a natural response to the two-party system that we have generally in this country. And in order to actually get our philosophy and our viewpoint known, they wanted to put together a political party and actually get on the ballots. And so we are neither Republican and we are neither Democratic. We actually have our own symbol, the porcupine. And if you have not seen that, you haven't met enough libertarians, I guess. So if anyone's ever taken a political quiz, most people think that there's a spectrum. It's either right or left. I believe it's not really a left versus right. It's actually like a diamond. All things are encompassing here. Okay. There are several different tests you can take online. There's something called the world's smallest political quiz. It's got like 10 questions on it. If you get your hand on one of those, it'll really kind of tell you where your beliefs truly are, whether you are more of a liberal-minded person or more of a conservative-minded, or at the bottom you see authoritarian. You're the person that wants everything controlled and dictated for you, or you want an absence of government. You want to make all those decisions yourself. But again, it is a philosophy. So even within a party, you're going to find different points of view. Just like Republicans can't all agree that Donald Trump would be the good guy to represent him, and I'm sure not all Democrats would believe that Hillary Clinton best represents them. Of course, even though we have a nominee in Gary Johnson, not all libertarians are in full alignment with him. It's just what happens with human nature. The basis of libertarian philosophy can be stated in 7 words. Don't hurt me and don't take my stuff. It seems pretty natural, right? We don't want people affecting us. We don't want people to take our stuff, our property. We don't want people to hurt us and to force violence on us. So we believe the government should be the same thing. Don't hurt me and don't take my stuff, right? We believe individuals have the legal right to do whatever they want with their bodies and their property, so long as they don't affect the equal right of another individual's body and property. That's the basis of libertarianism. Liberty is defined as do what you want as long as you're not affecting somebody else. I mean, isn't that a value that everyone could probably agree with, right? Well, there are 7 principles of libertarianism. If I go through these, I'll kind of get them itemized one by one here. The principle of self-ownership, the non-aggression principle, the principle of volunteerism and free exchange, the decentralization, property rights, and individualism. Those are the seven tenets of libertarian philosophy, and as we break them down, I'll kind of talk about them. The first one is self-ownership. We believe that you own yourself and your body. At the very basic level, nobody has a right to say whatever that you should be able to do with your body, including what kind of substances you're putting into your body. So you'll find a lot of libertarians are pro-drugs or pro-marijuana, because it's your body. You're not affecting anybody else. We believe that you should have responsibility based on the things that you do, but some of the alcohol laws out there is a little extreme, because again, it comes down to you own your body, what you eat, what you drink. There are a lot of types of politicians. In fact, I know of one here in Chicago, right? The county board president is trying to create a tax saying how much money they can take from sugary substances. I mean, this is your body. You should have the right to do what you want and then face the consequences. That is the principle of self-ownership. It says, my philosophy is based on the principle of self-ownership. You own your life. To deny this is to imply that another person has a higher claim on your life than you do. No other person or group of persons owns your life, nor do you own the lives of others. That's pure individual ownership. The second principle that libertarians share is what's known as the non-aggression principle. Now, that's a lot to read right there, but non-aggression principle is a moral philosophy. Basically says that nobody has the right to force their belief on you. We believe that the government doesn't have the right to force you to do anything that you don't want to do. And this also includes things like foreign affairs. We don't have the right to go and promote democracy all over the world. We don't have the right to go and say you need to live according to our values. And we don't certainly want to do it at the end of the gunpoint. I mean, let's face it. If you don't pay your taxes, who's going to come after you? Federal agents, right? And federal agents have guns. So you're pretty much at the mercy of a gun or a violent act, a potential violent act, if you don't comply with the laws. We don't believe that anybody has that right to force that violence on you. Now, a lot of people think libertarians are pacifists. I'm going to tell you that they're not pacifists, okay? We believe in what's called a non-interventionist foreign policy, right? We believe peace, having peace, commerce, and honest friendship with all nations, and have entangling alliances with none. We don't want to get involved in the affairs of other countries. We want to let them figure out their own nation and their own sovereignty and just be independent. Personally, I believe that here in the United States of America, we have all the resources that we could ever want. We don't necessarily need to worry about going to war over resources. We don't need to sit there and worry about going to battle to fight causes that not everyone believes in. So a lot of libertarians have this, you know, this very peaceful attitude. But I will tell you that there are criteria for the just rules of war. Sometimes war is necessary. It's a fact of life, it's sad, and not everyone agrees with it, but this is known for the just rules of war. Okay, I'll just read them here. The cause must be just. You must have a legitimate reason to have to go into war with another country. It must be undertaken by a legitimate authority. In other words, here in the United States, wars have to be declared by Congress. They cannot just be declared by the President of the United States, where I'm just going to go take my army. Even though that person holds the title of Commander-in-Chief, there is a process to actually go into battle with other countries. War must be used as a last resort. In other words, we have to have some kind of diplomacy. We believe that you can't just go start a war just because. You should try it as the very last option. There must be a declaration of war. Going back again, Congress needs to declare war. It can't just be said and declared by the President of the United States. The good that it hopes to achieve must outweigh the bad. In other words, if you're going to go into war and you're going to have lives that are lost, there must be an end goal in mind. You can't just go in retaliation for some event or something happened. You must have a strategic outcome, why this battle, why this war needs to be fought, and hopefully that the good results out of that, the end goal being peace, instead of just prolonged warfare. Again, it's not about being a pacifist because libertarians are in support of the Second Amendment. We believe that if we are unjustly attacked, we want to be able to have the right to protect ourselves. So, again, the Second Amendment says a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the rights of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. Now, I'm not here to debate the merits of that amendment, but it is a written amendment in the Constitution of the United States, and we do support that amendment. George Washington himself, he said, a free people ought not only to be armed and disciplined, but they should be...
They should have sufficient arms and ammunition to maintain a status of independence from any who might attempt to abuse them, which would include their own government.
Thank you. Thank you. So we definitely believe that protection here at home from either a tyrannical government or just from any kind of threat to the individual family and individuality of every person, we should have the right to protect ourselves. The third concept is volunteerism, okay? Arrangements and institutions in society are based on voluntary participation. That can mean any number of things. So the basis of society are individuals gathering together in a civilized manner. Here we are in a room in a restaurant, and I don't know how many of you know each other, but I don't know anybody in the room before tonight. And we're all here civilly and socially, and we're here for a common purpose. It's a volunteer society. That's how society forms. And so volunteering is the ultimate exercise in democracy. You vote in elections once a year, but when you volunteer, you vote every day about the kind of community you want to live in. So we have volunteer organizations like churches, we have volunteer organizations like scouting programs, we have volunteer organizations like sporting events. And so all that stuff is a natural happenstance of humanity. We don't need governments to sit there and divide us into different groups because it's us all a voluntary form, including charity and welfare. We don't need to be told that we have to give to the poor. We don't need to have tags taken for the welfare people. We have the right, and even historically, those who want to be charitable have their right to be charitable and should be charitable. And those who do not want to be, well, that's on them as well. But it should not come of force or government regulation. That's all an individual basis. The fourth principle of libertarians is known as free exchange. 100% we believe in a free market and free enterprise, okay? I'm a capitalist. I believe that economies are run by the natural progression of people trying to change one thing or another. In fact, a famous economist, Milton Friedman, said the most important single central fact about a free market is that no exchange takes place unless both parties benefit. So if I'm going to be giving you my time and my labor, the benefit is I get a paycheck for that. If I'm going to be selling you my car, then the benefit I get is a payment for that car, and you should have a reliable vehicle for that payment. That's the free market, and that's going to happen naturally. We don't need government regulation to say what we can buy and sell with each other. Individuals are free to exchange their property, any arrangements they see fit without government regulation, interference, or taxation. So I love this slide. I don't know how many people know this, but 1913 is the year that the free market in this country died. All right, so much has happened. The Federal Reserve Act, okay? If those of you who have studied free markets economics and know about fiat money system, what have we had over the last 100 years because of this fiat money we have? We have a decreasing dollar. The value of money is getting less and less. We have this arbitrary inflation that takes place because the money gets watered down all the time. That is huge, and how it hurts the average American family. So Ron Paul, famous libertarian thinker, he wrote a book called End of Fed. What's interesting is that many people don't know who this gentleman is, Mayor Amschel Rothschild. He was actually known as the godfather of centralized banking. Okay, he said, "Let me issue and control a nation's money, and I care not who writes the laws." What that's telling you is that it doesn't matter if we are in a democracy, a republic, or a communist country, the money is the one that's really affecting individuals at the plain level, at the basic level. And so if you have government involved in your money and that exchange, that's where all the problems are. That's where the division from the haves and the have-nots come from, is because somebody's planning that whole economy for you instead of letting it happen naturally. The president has very little effect on our economy. So anybody who's going to say, "I'm going to vote for Trump because of taxes, or because of the market, or I'm going to vote for Clinton because it's the other way," the business cycle is run because of the Federal Reserve, because of the monetary decisions that are made at that level. And if you didn't know this, the Federal Reserve, although it says federal in it, has nothing to do with the government. It's an institution of private bankers. It's a cartel of banks who make that decision, and the government is basically at their beck and call. They have no real decision in how that money is. It's a private organization, and I say it's a cartel because just like drug cartels, in every sense of the word, they make those decisions that get the wealthy people who are involved in that wealthier and at the expense of everyone else. One of my favorite presidents, Calvin Coolidge. They call him Silent Cal because he didn't do much in the government. He wasn't one of these guys that says, we need to do this, we need to do that. He was, let's just follow the Constitution. Let's just follow what was already written 100 years before him. He said, a government which lays taxes on the people not required by urgent public necessity and sound public policy is not a protector of liberty, but an instrument of tyranny. It condemns the citizen to servitude. I don't know if you can see this or not, but there's a little example here. It's different between sharing and taxation, okay? If you give somebody money for something, then that's a voluntary decision. If you want to help the less fortunate with your charity and welfare, that's on you. But when IRS comes and they point a gun at you, say, you have to pay our taxes or you're going to face the consequence, we believe taxation is theft. There's one to debate later. Taxation is theft. Taxation without representation, we've heard that phrase before in history, right? So the sixth tenet is decentralization. How many people know who John Stossel is? So he's actually got a show. He's a libertarian thinker, and he's got a show on Fox TV. So he says something about what decentralization is. He says the political class cannot imagine a decentralized world where good things happen without them. But in the real world, that's exactly how good things happen and how jobs are created. When the government sets simple rules that everyone understands and then gets out of the way, free people create jobs. So again, it's about this limited government. Government does not create jobs. It's the market. It happens naturally. It's the free principle of exchange. We believe that centralized power is much more easily corrupted and more dangerous. Power should be decentralized throughout a market process. Going back down to individual states or individual localities. We have City of Chicago. It has its own rules and regulations. And we have the city of where I'm from Elgin. On the local level, those markets, that society, is the basic foundation of where people's freedoms come from. And we put it all together in the middle, we can see on either side of major political parties where corruption is actually easily achieved. And that's because of this idea that one centralized place will be able to control everyone's thoughts. And that's really what we don't want to have in this country. Part of that decentralization is also the 10th Amendment. Yes.
We're in the dark half an hour.
Yeah, I've got like 3 more slides.
Not cut off now, but just, not another half hour. Okay.
So, we believe in a 10th Amendment. The 10th Amendment says the power is not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited to it by the states, are reserved to the states respectively, or to the people. All right, so we believe that a lot of the decisions that are made in Washington, D.C., a lot of these government agencies, if you would, we could do away with. I'm not going to read them all here, but most of the decisions made can be made on local level rather from Washington, D.C. Number six is property rights, right? Going back to John Locke, we have a right to property. Okay, no person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. Okay, that was Amendment 5 of the Constitution of the United States. Society has a right to own property. We should have the right to do what we want with that property, and we should not have regulations about what we do. We should not have regulations on when we build our house or how we build our house or what we put on our house or what kind of vehicle we drive. And the list goes on and on. We have a right to, by the strength and power of our own hands and our own resources, to achieve property, and we should be able to have that protected. There are four basic types of property, land, real estate. There are certain laws that make it hard in the real estate industry.
Oh, I know what I want.
We believe you should have personal properties, movables, again, vehicles, clothing, anything that you can move around with you. Trusts, your assets. I come from a financial background, so I know all about the laws that are in place for the securities and the retirement assets you have, and your bank account, all kinds of things. We believe that it should all be regulated by the market rather than by the government. And of course, intellectual property, that should be protected. There's wonderful ideas out there, and innovations and ideas that we need to have protected from interests that will take them from us. So that would probably be one of the uses that government would be in our favor, is to protect those kind of things. The seventh one is individualism. This idea that we are individuals, okay? Famous author Ayn Rand said something really profound here. He said, an individualist is a man or woman who says, I will not run anyone's life, nor let anyone run mine. I will not rule nor be ruled. I will not be a master nor a slave. I will not sacrifice myself to anyone, nor sacrifice anyone to myself. As libertarians, we believe that everybody has individual rights. You're not going to see this thing called racism among libertarian thinkers, because everybody has the same rights, whether you're black, white, male, female, brown, blue, orange, whatever color you are, you have the same basic natural rights. So the cure to racism is individualism. The opposite of that is collectiveness. When everyone tries to collect, okay, racism exists because everyone believes that I have a certain characteristic in my life that has to be like everybody else. Okay, that's the basis of racism. And there's all kinds of other collective mentality, and if you break that apart, everyone's an individual. It doesn't matter where you come from, what you look like, how tall you are, any of that. You have the same rights, and that's an important facet right there. Again, one of my favorite figureheads, Martin Luther King, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. This is basically saying that in today's political society, you have this organization, Black Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, that's all done away with. Because it's not a racist thing. Everybody has rights, everyone has the same protections, and if you think like that, then all that goes away. We don't have to worry about racism, we have to worry about injustice, because if somebody's rights are being infringed, then it's the responsibility of the government to protect those rights, and we should all stand up for those individual rights, no matter what background you have. I'm going to conclude with this. Libertarians believe that we can maximize liberty and prosperity only without government. If we act as individuals and we take care of our own life, our freedom of life, our liberties we have do that will not infringe on anyone else's rights, we're all going to be more prosperous. Thus, prosperity and peace comes from this philosophy. And I like this one down here. It says, libertarians, because we are going to push our candidates, libertarians are plotting to take over the world and leave you all alone. So, I'm going to introduce our next speaker. He's going to get to more of the actual real day issues that face libertarian thinking, and then we'll open up the debate after we actually meet our candidate for a U.S. Senator. So, I'm going to introduce Matthew Scaro. All right.
Guys, let's give a round of applause for Mike once again. Mike, I think you did an excellent job in laying out the ideology of libertarianism, because in the end, that's what we're talking about here right now, is the ideology of libertarianism. Today, libertarianism is also a political party. So there actually has to be a pragmatic approach to the libertarian ideology. So how do we apply the libertarian philosophy in our daily lives, in our governments, at the municipal level, the state level, and at the federal level? And that is what I am here to talk to you about today. Now, it's really important that you understand that I'm an individual, right? I am here representing the Libertarian Party, but I'm not perfect. I'm going to say some things that you may not agree with. I may make some mistakes, and I may offend some of you, and that's not my intent. My intent today here is to talk to you about how we can improve our current situation. So, looking at the presidential debates, that's on everyone's mind today, right? We're less than 3 weeks away from the major election. Most of the people are not happy with the two candidates they see on the debate stage. Most people are going to vote for one of them in order to make sure that the other one does not get elected. Most people would like to see a third party candidate on the debate stage. These are facts. Now, I actually believe that we really only have one party right now in politics. I believe that libertarians are not a third party, but I believe that libertarians would be a second party. And I think that there are some statistics that would support what I am proposing here. So, Ronald Reagan, let's go back to Ronald Reagan. Republicans will tell you that Ronald Reagan was the economic end-all be-all, right? Reaganomics, that was what fixed everything. Even Ronald Reagan raised the national debt. Our debt-to-GDP ratio has grown every year since Ronald Reagan. And every president in all of these administrations have also used the United States military in wars of aggression. The last time we went to war was 1941, World War II. That means Vietnam, Grenada, Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan. Help me out, folks, I'm gonna miss them here. Egypt, who else have we bombed?
Panama.
There we go. So I could give you a laundry list. None of these were authorized wars. They're not allowed to do that. War is vested within Congress. It's in Article 1 of the Constitution. Every single president since then has also taken away a number of our civil liberties. So I look at these three things, right? Our foreign policy, our domestic policy, and our economic and monetary policy, and I say that that the Republicans and the Democrats, by and large, on a macro scale, have done the same things. Maybe we can point out small differences on a micro level, but on a macro level, they're doing the same thing. So libertarians would be a second party. They would not be a third party. But how do we actually get some libertarians into office? Well, we have to get people out there to vote, right? We have to get people to actually move away from just voting party line, Republican, Democrat, and actually voting for a person, for a candidate. I've said this numerous times before to people that I propose that the general public should choose a candidate whom they believe will best serve our country within the confines and restrictions of the Constitution, regardless of their electability. If we do that, then things can change. Because this is your country. It's not my country. It's not the Republicans' country. It's not the Democrats' country. It's your country. It was fought for you. It was very expensive. We often hear, again, that the wasted vote. A vote for a Libertarian candidate is a vote for Hillary Clinton. A vote for a Libertarian candidate is a vote for Donald Trump. Well, this is not true, okay? Number one, it's a logical fallacy. It's a complete logical fallacy. That is not what it means. Regardless, again, no matter who you vote for, even if you're voting to make sure that someone does not get in office, you're never going to be viewed as rejecting that candidate. You're only going to be viewed as supporting the candidate in whose name you checked. So if the majority of the people are going to continue to vote for the lesser of two evils, they're only going to get evil. Einstein defined insanity as doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. We have two candidates here, and the majority of the people say that they are both evil, that they're going to vote for the lesser of two evils. Well, the outcome is an evil candidate, right? The outcome is an evil president. And if we continue to do that, and we think things are going to change, that's insanity, by definition. So what I'm proposing here are some alternatives. And I'd like to talk, you know, about how you can also apply libertarianism in your personal life. I apply the non-aggression principle that Mike talked about in my personal life. I try to never tell people that they are stupid, that they are wrong, or that their vote doesn't matter, or that their vote is wrong. I don't think it's my place, and I hope that no part of what I say tonight makes you believe that, because I don't believe any of you are wrong, okay? I don't have the right. We can use the non-aggression principle in a number of different manners. We use it when we debate people. Today, when we talk about our presidential candidates, we hear a lot of things like Gary Johnson is stupid, right? Because Gary Johnson didn't know where Aleppo was. I actually think that may be a benefit. Maybe he's not thinking about going to war with Syria. Maybe he's not thinking about petroleum. Maybe he's not thinking about wars of aggression and imperialism. Or we might hear that Donald Trump is crazy. Okay?
Yeah.
Or we might hear that Hillary Clinton is a crook, or that she's committed treason, or fraud, or extortion, or burglary, or there's a number of things. Yes. Okay. So let's use facts, guys. That's how we should debate facts. Gary Johnson supports the TPP. I don't agree with that. So if you ask me why I'm having trouble with Gary Johnson, I'll tell you the truth. It's that I don't like the TPP. I'm not a fan of it. Donald Trump says that he will enforce stop and frisk. Well, Donald, in 2013, the Supreme Court ruled stop and frisk unconstitutional. So you can't do that. Unfortunately, the right is just not vested with the president to do that. He's also said that he wants to make other nations pay for our defense. Well, you don't get a right to sell our men and women in uniform as a service. Our boys in blue, our men and women in our armed forces are not for sale. They never should be. And by the way, that does not go just for Donald Trump. That also goes for Obama and for Hillary, because you have sold them. And I certainly cannot accept that. But if we use facts, if we use actual statistics to support our cause, this is not aggression. You're not telling people that they're wrong. You're not telling people that they're stupid. But I will point out that the Libertarian candidate is the only candidate right now who's not talking about going to war. I don't think anyone in this room likes war. I don't think anyone in this room wants war. He's the only one not talking about going to war. But really, is he the one who's going to have the most effect in your daily life? I don't think so. I think that guys like Kent McMillen might have a little bit more effect in your daily life. He's going to speak after me. And I would really love for you folks to look at Claire Ball. Claire Ball is running for Comptroller of Illinois. Believe it or not, okay, so the Comptroller is essentially the account for Illinois. We have never had a Comptroller with an accounting degree. I know. That's crazy. Claire Ball does. Claire Ball is by far the most qualified candidate. We don't hear about her in the media, but she is. And I would say that applying libertarianism, if you vote libertarian, you can actually affect change. Not only is your vote not wasted, it will help. Because if we get 5% as a state, we will become a major party in the state of Illinois. If Gary Johnson gets 5% federally, we will become a major party all across. We will get federal funding, which is a bit ironic. I'm not sure we'd want to accept it. But the point is this, is that a third-party vote for libertarians actually will make a difference. You folks can make a difference. And I guess I just want to say, in closing, this country is so much more than just a collection of 50 states. Population, it's an idea. It was an experiment in freedom. It's your country. You can change it. We the people can change it. I thank you all for your attention this evening. I thank you for letting me talk and for listening to me. Thank you. Thank you.
Introduce our next speaker. Introduce our next speaker.
Well, it is my great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, United States Senate candidate, Kent McMillen.
Kent, what's your website?
Website is Kent, the number 4, Senate.com. And I believe pretty much everyone has received one of my cards. So you'll see it right on the cards. That's easy to remember. And that'll also take you to my Facebook and my Twitter. It's at Kent, the number 4, Senate.com.
Got it up.
Thank you so much for having us tonight. Thank you so much for being here. Again, my name is Kent McMillen. I like to say I'm a regular guy running for U.S. Senate. I'm not an ideologue. I'm not a policy wonk. But through my life, I've tried to live my life with clarity, common sense, and good judgment.
Okay. Can you move back a little bit from the mic?
Sure. How's this?
That's probably better. Yeah.
Okay. Great. One word, I believe, overrules every other word is responsibility. Everything starts with responsibility. Responsibility leads to freedom, and freedom leads to prosperity. The fewer responsible people we have, the more laws we have. The fewer responsible people we have, the more people we have dependent on things like Social Security. The few responsible people we have means more people are dependent on things like Medicare. So I'm advocating for a more responsible country so we can have more freedom and we can have more prosperity. One leads to another. Talk about my personal situation just for a second. I separated from my ex-wife when my two children were very young. And so for well over 10 years, I paid child support. So in effect, I was making two mortgage payments a month for over 10 years. So just think about well over $2,000 coming out of your paycheck, every paycheck. And I still had to support myself. I didn't complain, because I chose that situation. But I chose to live within my means and plan for my future. And today, I have no mortgage, I have no debt, and I have more than five times the average amount saved for retirement for someone my age. That's what you get when you're responsible and you plan for your future. And if more people did that, this country would be in a better condition. Now, why am I running? First of all, we need choice. We need more choices in candidates. Who would get excited to go to a place called Baskin Robbins Two Flavors? Nobody, right? We've had the Democrats and the Republicans for a long time. And I'm just trying to give folks another choice. And I'm not a politician. I don't want to make a career out of this. If I'm fortunate enough to be elected in November, I will serve one term and one term only. I will not spend a dime or a minute on re-election. But every minute I am in office, I will be serving the people of Illinois. And then I will turn the keys over to a younger and smarter libertarian, which in my case will not be that difficult. Also, some issues are not being discussed. We have over $19 trillion in debt. No one's talking about that. We have troops in all kinds of countries, including Germany, Italy, and Japan. I say, let's start bringing some of those good folks home and putting them to use here for whatever reason. Let that be decided. We have a drug war in which we've spent over $1 trillion over the past 30 years. And guess what? There hasn't been a drop in drug usage. I say move the emphasis from incarceration to treatment. If we're going to spend money, let's give these folks help. Don't put them in jail. Put them in treatment. No one's talking about that. Veterans should be able to go to their local doctors for treatment. They shouldn't have to deal with the bureaucracy that is the VA. I'll gladly give up my 10 a.m. appointment on a Tuesday for one of our heroes. But again, no one's talking about that. I was born way back in 1961. Believe it or not, at that point, we didn't have a Department of Education. We didn't have a Department of Transportation. We didn't have a Department of Interior. And we didn't have a Department of Housing and Urban Development. Now, I gotta admit, I was pretty young when I was born. So I don't quite remember what was going on. But I've asked folks that are a little bit more senior than me, and they said, yeah,
life went on just fine with all of those new federal agencies with tens of thousands of employees making a lot of money and getting nice pensions. I just say the government has gotten too big. And I'm up here saying enough. 750,000 employees in the Department of Defense were not in the military. 250 trade offices worldwide under the Commerce Department. Over 500 subsidy programs under the Department of Housing and Urban Housing and Human Services. Thank you. Almost half a billion acres of land under the control of the Department of the Interior. So by voting for me, you're voting to change that trajectory. About 38% of the federal revenues are from individual income taxes. So just think for a minute, if we could lower the size of the federal government by a third over time, be it 2, 3, 5 years, we could effectively eliminate the individual income tax. It's a matter of the people that you are electing to federal office. These are the people that are making the decisions. And these are the people that have the relationships with defense contractors and big pharma and lobbyists and special interests, which are raising the debt and costing you money by higher taxation. No one's talking about Social Security. Everybody's kicking the can down the road. The trustees have said themselves that the loaning bill pays about 75% of benefits in less than 20 years. Now, if you're 70 years old, that's really not going to affect you. But what if you have children that are 25 or 30? Is it right for them to pay a higher tax for Social Security than we pay? I don't think so. I think we need to move towards a individual retirement system based on your own talents and your own ability to save money and effectively eliminate Social Security. Again, it won't happen overnight. I understand that. But it's not an investment program, folks. It's a tax. And you're not entitled to it. African-American men don't live as long as white men do. They can work their whole life, retire for 2 years and die, and all that money they put in, they won't see much of it. So essentially, this is why I'm running, to bring up issues that the Republicans and the Democrats will not bring up. And these are things I'd like you folks to think about. And go to kentforsenate.com. Take a look at what I'm saying. And if you're not happy with the status quo, I ask you to stand with me this November and send a statement. There are four people on the ballot for U.S. Senate. Two of them you probably know, Senator Kirk and Congresswoman Duckworth. Two you probably didn't know until tonight, at least me. Myself, Libertarian candidate, and Scott Summers, the Green Party candidate. Four people in the state of Illinois are on the ballot for U.S. Senate this fall. And I think it would send a strong message to whoever wins this race if the winner gets less than 40% of the vote. And tell them that the majority of people weren't your first choice. So those are the things I stand for. Those are the things I'm talking about. And those are the things, when you leave here tonight, I would like you all to think about. Because it does matter to you, and it will matter to your children and your grandchildren. If we don't stop the way we're going, we are not going to give as good a life to the next couple of generations. So thank you so much for listening.
All right.
Okay. I would like to introduce
via a small campaign commercial that I think is probably one of the most effective online.
Who exactly Gary Johnson and William Weld are for the President of the United States. It's a very brief 2 minutes. We can pull it up here real quick.
I'm Governor Gary Johnson.
I'm Governor Bill Weld.
I'm running for president.
I'm running with him.
As the governor of New Mexico, I vetoed wasteful spending 750 times, cut taxes 14 times, and left the state with new highways, bridges, schools, hospitals, and a $1 billion surplus without raising taxes a penny.
As governor of Massachusetts, I cut taxes 21 times and took unemployment from the highest rate among the 11 industrialized states to the lowest.
And he did that in his first term.
It was easy.
As a Republican, I was re-elected by my Democrat state in a landslide.
Ditto.
I support marriage equality.
I support a woman's right to choose.
I want term limits.
Internet freedom is a must.
Intelligent immigration reform.
Small, efficient government that treats the American people like family instead of livestock.
I believe in personal freedom.
I want government out of your pocketbook and out of your bedroom.
It's time to end the wars and use those dollars here at home. The difference between the two of us and the other candidates running for president is that we've been there.
And done that.
We both balance budgets.
We've both battled corruption and won.
Give us one term, America, and if after 4 years you decide you don't like peace, prosperity, and freedom, you can always vote a Trump or a Hillary back into office again. What say, America? You in?
Come on. I would like to turn our forum over to Andy Anderson to continue moderating our question and answer period. And I'd like to get our speakers up here if they could, so they can answer questions, all three of you. And we will have an intensive question and answer period. And then we will have followed up by our infamous rebuttal period at the College of Conferences. Andy, if you're ready to come on up and rebuttal, we'll get our thing started here.
I think we need a battery in there.
Get your mouth right here.
Yeah, it's really bad.
All right, we'll get a battery set up. Just make sure you speak loudly enough so we can hear you.
Can you hear that back there, Charlie?
I know.
That's not garbled now.
I have a question.
No.
Don't talk right into the mic. Hold it a few inches away. Okay.
Okay, I have a question.
Okay.
Okay, questions. You over there.
Yes.
Lady in the red coat.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
What's your question?
Excuse my English.
Loud.
My English, my third language, actually. I have a very patient with my English, okay? But what's pretty much bothering me, and I have concern. And I have a question for Mr. Kent McMillen, if I may. You mentioned here in this flyer so many issues, which we appreciated, but you didn't mention nothing about Social Security. And Social Security, it looked like very shaking. And I heard from some people, you know, who go to Social Security Administration office, they feel like they're so humiliated, even they work more than 35 years, they feel like these people in Social Security workers, they sort of humiliate them. They feel like they're criminal, okay? So they come to Social Security for help, for eligible help. So my question to you, how to make really Social Security not only blah, 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 but make Social Security stable for people who deserve to have Social Security, Medicare and Medicaid, coming to the age and coming to situations. Okay, even health or whatever. And I would like to know why you mentioned nothing about the safe Social Security, so Social Security can be more stable. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for the question.
About a fist away is what you wanted with a mic like that.
How's this?
Yeah.
Right, well, thank you for the question. There's only so much room I can put on that thing, so. It's basically meant as like an introductory thing of some of the things. There's obviously all kinds of issues that, you know, if you go to my website, you'll see how I feel about Social Security and about guns and about a number of other things that are not on that flyer. So that, you know, just from a technical standpoint, that's just like an introductory to me. I did speak about Social Security at the end of my talk a few minutes ago. I'm not sure if you heard it. But basically, I'm not in favor of stabilizing it and keeping it. I'm in favor of eliminating it. Not overnight, but it's not set up as a retirement program. It's set up as a tax, and it's unfair to certain types of people, namely African Americans who don't live as long, and guys that work in factories and things like that, who their bodies get torn down over their years of work. And if they retire at, say, 65, 66, and they die a year later, well, they put all that money into Social Security, and they've got nothing for it. So it's basically a tax for the common good. So one of our former presidential candidates, Harry Brown, his solution, we have trillions of dollars in federal assets, like national parks, pipelines, open lands, government buildings, and in conjunction with making the government smaller and putting more money in your pocket, his idea was to sell those federal assets and purchase annuities, primarily or initially for the most needy seniors, and eventually eliminating the program by virtue of those sales. So by making the government smaller, we could eliminate Social Security. And but you know, for folks that are older, you wouldn't lose out. You would just get your money from a different source. And for younger folks, you'd be told at the age of 18 or 20 or whenever you start working that there's no government safety net. But what a lot of and I've talked to a lot of younger people about Social Security. And what they don't know, and I'm sure most of you folks know, is the employer puts in that tax as well. So that affects how much money you're going to make at a job, because your employer has to pay into that. So at the age of 18, 21, or whenever you start working, over the course of 40, 50 years of you working, by virtue of you and your employer not having to pay into Social Security, you can make a heck of a lot more money over a lifetime, and you'll make more of a salary. And even if you put it into a conservative index fund, at the age of 60 or 62, you'll have a heck of a lot more money than you would by waiting for a Social Security check every month. So, again, in my opinion, it's not a good system. It's not viable. It's in very poor health right now. The trustees have said so. And the only way to make it more viable is to either raise the cap, raise the retirement age, or make our younger workers pay more. And I don't think any of those are good options.
Okay.
Thank you.
Charles.
Charlie?
Charlie.
Did you hear the mic
there?
Okay.
Yeah.
It's all right. You covered it on me.
Okay, go ahead, sir. What's your question?
My employer provides my retirement. If the guy works 40 years for some, making some guy rich, and then at the end of 40 years, the owner of the company says, thanks a lot, I'll see you around sometime. And you're saying you want everyone to have their own individual retirement accounts?
Right.
After you made some guy rich, you made that company rich, you made it wealthier, and they just say thank you very much.
Are you referring to pensions?
Yeah,
whatever. Annuities would be purchased from an insurance company, and you would have the same, effectively have the same result as a Social Security check. And that would only be for the older folks.
I don't get Social Security. I don't get a Social Security check.
Okay, but you wouldn't be affected if it's because of your age. But I'm talking about eliminating the program over time by virtue of selling the federal assets. And for younger workers, making them understand that that's not going to be a safety net for their future. Again, it's not something that's going to happen overnight, and older folks would not lose anything. They would get their money from somebody else by virtue of the sale of federal assets.
You don't have a right, you should not be allowed to hire anybody if you're not going to provide for their retirement.
I'm agreed.
They don't do
company
pensions anymore.
Why?
Okay, again, you're talking about rights
you cannot
that you think are right. It's some sort of a fundamental right. But we don't believe it's a fundamental right that an employer should have to provide for your retirement. We believe you should have to provide for your retirement.
Yeah, wait a minute. I'm not going to argue this. You work 40 years for some guy, and then he says, now it's the government responsibility, or you're on your own, Bill. See you around. That's the system you are proposing.
Clarify that question.
Well, I'm proposing at a young age, an individual has the right and the responsibility to provide for his own retirement. Now again, I talked about responsibility at the beginning of my speech. And with responsibility comes freedom. So that's the price of freedom, is you have to be responsible. So it shouldn't inure to a system where an employer is responsible for your retirement. Your employer is responsible to pay you a wage that they think is your worth. That's it. Yeah, what am I talking about?
So I have some experience in the retirement planning business. I said earlier I was a businessman. What I actually do for a living, I'm a personal financial consultant. Okay, so here's the thing about Social Security. When it got started in 1930, we had an average of 43 workers paying into Social Security to pay one person who got the benefits. Okay, over the last 70 years in this country, we've seen that decrease. So now there are an average of 2 to 3 people paying into Social Security for the benefit of one person. That's not sustainable, okay? Ken had mentioned you want to have personal responsibility. Here's the thing, we understand at this day and age, there are many people who are relying on that Social Security. We're not talking about getting rid of it overnight. No presidential candidate, no matter what political party you come from, is going to win any kind of vote with that solution. You can't just absolve it, okay? But personal responsibility has to be going forward. So those of you who are now in that time period where you need Social Security, yeah, you're going to get those benefits. You're going to have that kind of stuff, okay? But we believe that you should have an age limit, say age 50. You can opt out. You're 50 or younger, opt out of Social Security and assume that personal responsibility. Here's the thing. When you actually are working for a company, they used to have this thing called pensions, right? Where a company you work for, you say, you know, you work for us for 40 years, we'll take care of your retirement. And we've seen that go away, right? Pensions are almost non-existent now. So they came up with this thing called a defined contribution plan, otherwise known as a 401k. And what happened? You work for a company, and half of your money will go toward this plan, and half of the employer's money will go to that plan. And then, you know, if you want to retire, great, good luck to you. What's happening now? 401ks are optional for even employer contributions. You work for us, we have this thing, it's a 401k, you can put money into it, good luck. So if you have the opportunity, and it goes through marketing with the insurance companies and other retirement companies, you can actually have that personal responsibility going forward. We don't want anybody who's now living in Social Security to get rid of that program. It's not going to happen.
That's right.
Okay.
Tell them you saved your own money.
All right. I'd like to know what your guys' views are on climate change and how you propose to solve it, if you believe it.
You're going to have to redefine climate change. I mean, the weather changes every day here in Chicago.
What I'm saying is that for a lot of the preponderance of scientists, particularly in the Green Party, they have said that man has caused climate change to the planet, where our sea levels are going to rise because of the increasing amounts of carbon in there. Jill Stein from the Green Party is advocating an emergency plan to go to green energy. A lot of different companies are saying we want to go green. Can you at least comment on it or tell us why or why you may not believe it?
Well, I can't speak on behalf of Jill Stein. I don't really support the Green Party, nor have I done much investigation as to what they believe. Here's what my personal belief about climate change is, okay? The climate has changed several thousand times over the thousand years or more that humans have been in this world, okay? I mean, there are things called ice ages, which happened way before any of us in this industrial revolution emitted any of these carbon emissions into the atmosphere, okay? Here's a fact. Human beings cannot stop hurricanes from happening. If you can't stop a hurricane from happening, how the heck are we responsible for causing them to happen? I don't believe that there's anything that humans are doing. Science has said that more carbon emissions have been emitted to the atmosphere from a single volcano than anything man has ever done. And so when you have a government that's trying to regulate carbon emissions, you're really just killing the market. There are all kinds of innovations that people have. Now, again, like Ken said, I believe you should have responsibility.
Right.
You know, one of the things that comes with private property rights, if you are a company that is polluting the atmosphere, and that atmosphere, which is shared by other individuals who own property, is now being affected, well, that's a private property issue. So now you can go to court against that company, You don't need a government to say, well, we need to have EPA regulations against that, okay? It's private property, and you can decide on the private property issues on an individual basis. I mean, we saw the movie Aaron Brockovich, and what did they do to that company when they were polluting the water? It's all through the court system.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. I mean, if you folks want to hear my opinion on it,
yes.
I actually am going to probably stand out a little bit here from the Libertarian Party and say that I do think that there are a number of things that are causing global warming that are a result of our manufacturing and industrial industry. Okay, so I do believe that. I also believe that it's very, very difficult to gauge the type of damage that a company will do. So say there's a pollutant that is put into the air, travels 100 miles, and somebody gets cancer 50 years down the road. It's going to be really hard for that person to sue the company. So I know that this is probably not the most libertarian answer you're going to hear all day, but that's the truth. And climate change, to say that climate change doesn't happen is like denying evolution to me. Of course, like he said, the climate changes every day here. Global warming, I do believe, is a very, very real thing as well. I'm not 100% certain, and I'm not an expert about what causes it. But I sometimes look at it and I say it's like asking to talk to the captain on the Titanic when I just want to know where the lifeboat is. Yes, sir.
Okay.
It's my understanding that in the Soviet Union, the government took care of anybody's old age benefits. And I'd like to know what became of those benefits when the Soviet government collapsed.
Okay, if I could step in here. Number one, we're talking about American politics here. Yes, the Soviet Union is a completely different animal. And I don't think that we're going to talk about the tenets of communism and socialism here. And as far as your comment about the people who feel shame and guilt in the Social Security office, they should not feel that shame and guilt. Franklin Delano Roosevelt maybe should feel that guilt, but they should not. And Charlie, I never really did understand your question when you said that I worked for 40 years and then my boss tells me, so long, goodbye. Was that referring to a pension, which would be provided by a private company, or were you referring to the federal government?
If a company goes bankrupt, they're not responsible.
Sure, okay, so we're talking about pensions.
Yeah, so they can just walk away.
Give me 1 second. Let me finish
here. Can they walk away from
it? Is that what you're talking about, Charlie? Is it pension?
Yeah.
Okay, pension's a whole different animal than Social Security. We're talking about a private company here.
It's a provision for people in their old age. And instead of the private employer who benefited by your employment, when you're no longer employable on a daily basis, it's totally he has no more responsibility for you whatsoever. Even though when you are making money for him, you're welcome. But when you're old and infirm, you're not. And he has no responsibility, and suddenly becomes the government's responsibility.
So we're saying that you worked 40 years for a company, you had a pension in writing that he did not honor?
Why doesn't every employer provide a retirement?
Why doesn't every employer require?
Yes, like they used to.
Okay.
You got this?
Let him
go ahead, Ken.
Go ahead, Ken.
Thank you.
Because people don't complain,
Pensions historically.
He doesn't believe it?
No.
It's a world you don't believe doesn't exist.
Pensions historically.
I didn't understand your question, Charlie.
Well,
it's a legal thing, Charlie. 401ks are bankruptcy remote, meaning if a company goes bankrupt, they can't take the money that you put in your 401k and keep it. Pensions are a different animal. Your pension payment, your pension check every month is dependent on the financial viability of the company you worked for. That's why we maintain that pensions are not a good idea. They're not guaranteed. And we've seen that in the auto industry, and we've seen that in other industries. They don't have the money, they say, we can't pay you. It's like if you go bankrupt, your secured creditors get paid first, your bondholders. Your stockholders are screwed.
I don't want to engage in a debate. I just read an article that CEOs are making 350 to 383 times more than the employees, and I assure you, every single one of those CEOs in those front offices gets a solid retirement.
Okay, so what are you...
And the guys on the shop floor...
Okay, so what is your suggestion? Is your suggestion to have all the companies run by the government and have all the CEOs make a certain salary?
If you offer a benefit to one employee, shouldn't it be...
Okay, well, that's obviously where we disagree. So, and we're not going to agree before the end of the night. So,
I'm a CEO of a company. I don't have any guaranteed retirement benefits. I'm not making 85% of whatever. I'm a small business owner. I'm the CEO of a company.
We're talking the real world.
I'm talking the real world
right now.
Yes.
And they are. I assure you. I guarantee you, because I know this for a fact. Every one of those CEOs is taken care of like you wouldn't believe.
I'm not taken care of,
like,
Charlie.
Who's taking care of? If you're talking about some fledgling companies, these are existing companies with workforces, sizable workforces, there's 50 or more.
As pensions get eliminated,
there's always a break-off for new employees in any legislative new companies when they reach a threshold. They're not under by it. That's old-fashioned. That's all in any law. But these are established corporations turn around, General Electric, pharmaceutical companies. Not providing for, and I don't need a savings account. I can go to the bank and get my own savings account. Oh, I need the employer.
There is a law that you mentioned this, or you started to mention this. It's called ERISA. It's what 401ks are. It just says that if one benefit is offered to any one employee in the company, every employee of that company has to be offered the same benefits. Okay. Now, individuals who have 401ks, they're not given the proper advice as to how to invest in those 401ks. Maybe individuals who have more money, who make more money, can pay for the advice. Okay, so that's one reason why, you know, people have certain investment strategies and others don't. Okay, as far as pensions go, you know, those are contracts within the company that you work for. If a company says, hey, we're going to offer you a pension and you work X number of years and we're going to pay you, well, then you have the choice to work for that company and take advantage of that. If you do not want that pension, you don't believe in a pension, then you have the freedom and responsibility to not work for that and take that responsibility to plan your own retirement yourself. I think that's the law.
Let's go here.
Okay.
All
right. I know we're talking about what you guys do. Can each one of you guys itemize your qualifications, education, graduate degrees, CEO of what? What have you guys done?
We don't do that, Mike.
Why?
Why? Because we are here to talk issues.
Can we talk about the qualifications?
If you don't want to.
What's wrong with that?
No, why not?
Hey, shut up. Hold on a minute.
What's wrong with asking their qualifications?
Get out of here.
This is a time for general questions about libertarian thought and philosophy.
No, I don't want to talk about it. I can't believe you don't want me to ask them their qualifications.
Charlie!
That's crazy.
You're wasting time, Charlie. Let's drop the issue. I think we should give each candidate maybe 20 seconds to just briefly introduce themselves.
We already heard.
Wasn't this supposed to be like a rebuttal or something? Somebody want to come up with a rebuttal? That'll be next. Who hasn't had a question?
I have a question.
Raj has it.
Okay.
Ask a question.
You guys are high on freedom. And I want to know what kind of freedom you are talking about and what kind of people are looking for those freedoms. Can you explain me?
What kind of freedom are we talking about? What kind of people are looking for freedom?
$5 trillion.
Freedom?
Yeah.
That's a very large word, sir.
No, it's not a large word. Okay, so make it small and tell me.
There's a number of different types of freedoms. It's all encompassing. I'd rather respond to that gentleman's inquiry about my background.
Let me explain you. If you don't understand, let me explain you.
Okay.
Okay, I'm a senior citizen.
Okay.
I'm sick. I got heart problem, I got blood pressure problem, I got pain in the ass, and I want to go to the doctor and I want the doctor to take care of me. Okay? I don't want freedom. I don't have money. I don't want freedom. Okay? I want my problem solved. Well, what are you talking about? So do I have freedom to die and not be taken care of?
Okay. Thank you.
That's what he means, I think.
Talking about rice instead of
food. Well, he's talking about medical care and
freedom
in conjunction with medical care. So as Mike said earlier, freedom basically is, you know, you're free to do what you want with your life as long as you don't invade someone else's space and take their stuff. With respect to medical care, right now you have the government basically dictating what kind of medical care you can have and how much it's going to cost, and you have to buy like an all-in-one inclusive policy, which you may not need. But what we would propose is similar when you go to like a restaurant like this, and you pick whatever you want on the menu, and you know how much it's going
to
cost before you get it. Our proposal would be you can go to any insurance company in the country to get medical insurance, and you can go to anywhere in the country by virtue of all those medical insurance companies to get operations conducted, and you can get pharmaceuticals from anywhere in the world. Right now, the federal government is restricting that. You can only get medical insurance from companies that are based here in Illinois, and Blue Cross and Blue Shield has about 3/4 of the market. So the competition is gone. So we propose more competition. More competition will bring the price of medical care down and will bring the quality up.
Sir, you don't understand. You see this? I have nothing.
Right, because of...
I have nothing, okay?
Right.
Okay, and I need a care in the hospital.
Okay.
Now. So, okay. So I do not have nothing, and you are talking about this scheme and that scheme. While I'm talking about that, I'm going to die if I don't get care.
Sir, you can go
and
to the hospital
and I have nothing in my pocket. Where can I go? Who will pay?
You go to the hospital. No, they will treat you without any money in your pocket. They can't turn you away.
The government will pay for it?
He's asking whether he can get the medical treatment with no money in his pocket. The answer is yes, he can.
Who will pay for it?
Well, in the end, don't you think the individual should pay for the services that they receive?
I don't have money. So who will pay for my hospital stay for 3 days?
Ultimately, that's a great question. Should I be the one to pay for it?
No, you tell me. You tell me.
Ultimately,
under your scheme, who will pay?
I don't have a scheme, sir.
No, sir, under your philosophy, just
it's a basic question.
Go ahead, Raj.
I can clarify that. Raj is asking, what about sick people that are facing life-threatening illnesses dying now? If the Libertarians get elected, will they just let those people die, or will there be some mechanism to give medical treatment and pay for it to people that are indigent?
There is. I mean, it's already in place. Nobody gets turned down.
Aren't you talking about changing it, though?
Here's the thing, though.
The philosophy of libertarianism is
not going to be a change overnight like that, okay? This mentality that if we vote for one candidate, everything will change in this direction, or we vote for another candidate, everything's going to change in that direction, is a fallacy. It's an ideology. It takes a systematic approach, okay? We don't have all the answers, but I don't think anybody has all the answers, okay? The basic of, we believe in a free market, okay? Yes, there's going to be those who are prosperous and those who are not prosperous. It's a sad fact of life. It doesn't matter what government you come from. It doesn't matter what country you live in. It's a human condition, okay? We believe that you need to have personal responsibility and that you should not be forced to take care of another individual who, for whatever reason, is not as fortunate as you. It's not our responsibility. If we want to be charitable, and there have been charities set up for this very purpose, then those things should be able to be developed naturally and not forced by the government. That's the basic principle. So I can't help everybody who's less fortunate. It's sad, but that's just the philosophy.
Is that your last question?
It's too bad, Raj.
Yeah, I know.
No, it's not too bad. It's not too bad, all right? The man is not going to be turned down for any service here. I think that really is the underlying issue here. And what you're proposing, sir, is that the government has a... Can I finish, sir?
Can you twist two sentences?
Can I finish?
In your philosophy, there is a project you are trying to put together that you create your own little commune.
I'm sorry? No.
Yeah. I read today on internet, all right. Okay? And the 4,000 or 5,000 people. Now, if you do that, then you'll find out that how it works and what I'm talking about, what other people are talking about, because that is a real life. If you have 5,000 people in your town, and then somebody's going to be smart, somebody's not, and that guy who is not smart, and he's going to need medical care, he's going to need food, he's going to need housing, then how are you going to handle? So why don't you do that and show me that how well your society and philosophy
work? You would like me to debate the argument of capitalism versus socialism or communism? right now?
That's for another night.
Here's the thing.
We're running close on time. Who has a question here?
All right.
You have one? Okay, this is
the last question.
I have a quick question.
Last question.
What about public schools? Are libertarians for public schools, or are they sort of like health care? You do it on your own, you educate yourself, get a book. I don't know, what about public libraries? No more public libraries, no more public schools? What about that?
Well, we don't believe in a centralized Department of Education, first of all. We don't believe in a federal Department of Education. So we believe it should be, all educational decisions should be moved down to the states. Uh-huh. And then from that point, it's up to the state how they want to do it. And you have choice as to what state you want to live in. And you elect state legislators to make those decisions for the schools. Ideally, I think parents should have choice in where they send their kids to schools, and the schools should be competitive with each other to provide the best education for your children. Right now, you go to schools depending on where you live. In a lot of places, I'm sure you only have one public school option to go to. So if you live wherever, your kids are automatically going to that school by virtue of you living there. And obviously, people move because they don't like the school district in their living. Their only option is to pay for a private school, which is a heck of a lot more than a public school. So what we would propose, and I'll be happy to turn over to these folks, is you know, open competition amongst schools, and let schools compete with each other for your children's education.
All right.
Let's wrap it up, people.
Can I just make one quick point?
Yeah, please.
I just want to make one quick point. There's many different types of libertarians here. All right, so if you get 10 libertarians in a room, you're going to get 10 different opinions. They say that it's like herding cats with us, all right? So certain libertarians are going to feel certain ways about certain issues. We're not all the same, okay? So I just wanted to point that out there.
Okay, yes. We now have to move on to rebuttals. It's about 8:15.
I have a question.
Sure.
Did anybody ask? I missed it because I was out, had to make an emergency phone call. Sorry about that. The U.S. military considers the threat of global warming and oceans rising and massive migration of people inward as the greatest threat. What would the Libertarian Party do to address that threat and also bring the troops home from every person?
We actually covered the first part. The second part is I spoke about places like Germany, Italy, and Japan.
What about the Middle East? The wars where they're killing people and contaminating lands with radioactive dust.
Yeah, well, we don't believe we're doing any good with our military involvement in the Middle East. So I believe in sharing intelligence with the countries.
I would
bring the troops home because our attempts at regime change hasn't helped those countries, and hasn't helped ours.
Okay, let's have a show of hands. How many people want to give a rebuttal? We got about 25 minutes total for rebuttals. Okay.
Okay.
Should we go sit down?
Yeah, you can go ahead and sit down now. And Andy, explain to our guests again how the rebuttals work.
The rebuttal period. Can everybody hear me? Well, here, the rebuttal period is where people will come up and give a reasoned rebuttal to the speaker's talks tonight, or anything else they want to say on the world situation. But I would suggest people talk about the issues of tonight. So we'll find out how many want to give a rebuttal and divide up the time accordingly.
Okay.
How many
Let's
hands?
Let's thank our speakers.
Let's thank our speakers.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, who wants to give a rebuttal? One, two, three, Charlie's four, I'm five. Is that five people?
Maybe. I think this gal here has a rebuttal, too.
No, I'm sorry.
Come on, darling.
All right.
Okay, if it's five people, everybody gets 5 minutes.
No, look, I have to go to four because,
four?
Yeah.
Well, you're right.
Go to 4 minutes each. We got a timer. Let's get up there and start rebutting, which means I'll go first.
All right.
You know, I have found this discussion tonight refreshing from the issues.
Just that on.
Huh?
Yeah, it's better. We can hear you.
All right. Well, I found the discussion tonight very refreshing. I guess I'm more of a libertarian than I thought I was. I like free markets. I like of things, but there are some things government does do with capitalism and free markets, and that is you don't have capitalism without capital. You don't have capital without some form of registry or database of assets. When you get a land, you can sell or buy that land because of a land title that's recognized by a government. You buy or sell a website domain name by a registry recognized by ICANN, the International Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. You don't buy a car without a title. And one of the reasons why I believe poor countries or third world countries are not rich like us, because in the United States, this is something we take very much for granted. And with the responsibilities of that, we have the courts, we have things like this. You also have to realize today, in a world of innovation and globalization, you can't do the basic research without a lot of people teaming up together and going forward on it. Now, I know I might not be much for government research and stuff like this, but there is a place for it. Now, as far as climate change and alternative energy, I firmly believe that the renewables and other things aren't going to cut it, and that it's probably going to take some form of nuclear power. I know Andy strongly and vehemently disagrees with me on that. I support the development of something called the liquid fluoride thorium reactor, which basically would, if it was implemented on a widespread basis, would virtually solve our fossil fuel addiction problem and also clean up the environment radically, as well as a solution to nuclear waste. However, that is just one of many other solutions I see. I like a lot of the ideas they have about the free markets, but I still see a role for government. For example, I like what's going on with the toll roads right now. Mm-hmm. You know, they're getting better, and I do know you pay tolls on those toll roads to use them. I'm not exactly sure if I'm pure libertarian, but I know I'm a lot more libertarian than I would like to admit as being a Democrat or a Republican.
That's a good start.
You know, the Republicrats, I don't like. Gary Johnson does get my support for president. I like him and William Weld's philosophy. And I have declared here and in the past, including my Facebook posts, my YouTube stuff, that I am officially supporting Gary Johnson for the Libertarian ticket. The reason I believe it is because I know that most of his policies probably won't get through Congress, but I do know that if we get him into office, we're going to start moving in the right direction and get some centralized reforms done for this country. Thank you. All right. You timing?
I got the timer.
Okay.
You got 4 minutes. Let me know when you're ready to start.
Ready.
Okay, go for it.
I've got two things I want to say. One thing is there's a certain woman in here that never ceases to keep interrupting and keep aggravating everybody, and it winds up giving me a headache. And I wish that our group leader or whatever would have a talk with her and get her to pipe down already. She does it every time. The other thing I wanted to say...
Is that a personal attack?
No, it's not. It's a plea to abide by the rule. Will you shut up a minute? It's a plea to abide by the rules that we have. Okay?
Follow the rules.
Well, the rules are that one fool at a time. Anyway, and that goes for you right now, too, Mr. Haddock. Meantime, I wanted to be able to say what I came up here to say. And that is that I like Donald Trump, and I hope very much that Donald Trump wins the election because he's for free enterprise. I don't believe that the libertarians are going to take the election this time, although I'm voting libertarian, as I have voted in every presidential election since 1980. And I liked Ronald Reagan, but I still voted libertarian. I think that the onslaught of libertarianism is inevitable, and eventually we will have a libertarian majority in government. Thank you.
This guy. He's got more to him than any of us.
My name is Raj Patel. I speak for myself. Guys, come on. That was awful. I mean, you don't have your things together. Oh. I'm sorry.
Sir, attack the policies, not the people.
Whatever it was, okay? I support Hillary Clinton. Do you know why? She knows things. She's knowledgeable. She knows how to deal with people. She knows how to talk to people. She knows how to articulate the topics and subject. Okay? She can do all those things. And nobody else can do it. You know, Gary Johnson, because I like Tim Bolger, and he's a libertarian. So Gary Johnson, I watch him twice on a TV, on a conversation. And do you know, it was awful. You know, he screwed up both times so badly. You feel sorry, and he should not be running for a Chicago alderman even. And he did, come on, I mean, you got to have something to be leader. You just cannot be a nice guy. I'm a nice guy, you know, I'm a nice husband, nice father, nice. It's okay. It goes only so far. Okay? Now look, nobody's looking for freedom. Everybody's looking for escape from freedom. Because right now, individual freedom, you can go so far. World has so complex. Everything is so complex that nobody can understand. Even our government doesn't understand what's going on. It's that complex. Okay? Our big industry do not understand, they fail. Okay? So idea of freedom, what you are talking about, you know, the management of our economy and management of life, lifestyle and work, and all those things, I mean, come on. It's no longer there. You need $500 million to create some of the projects. You want to go to moon and want to create a company, it takes lots of money, lots of technicians, lots of management, lots of smart people, and hey, it's not going to happen. You know, their guy trying to carry the taxi without drivers all over the country, you know, it requires lots of brawn and lots of muscles and lots of brain. And you are talking about things which doesn't make sense to me. I mean, nobody's looking for libertarian. I mean, come on. I'm sorry that there are some lost guys who are looking for being nice and, you know, she's nice to me and it says I'm going to be nice to her. You know, it doesn't work. What subject, what you have, what can you accomplish, what can you do, you know, are you charismatic leader that you can get the crowd up? At least Donald Trump, you know, I don't like him because he doesn't have a knowledge of government. He doesn't have a knowledge of issues. Okay, he doesn't know how to talk. I don't like it. But do you know something? He sure has a charisma and he sure has a leadership. Okay? You have to have something to create a party. You got to be a senator. You got to have something. You got to have some substance, some person, okay? Something that people say, wow, look at that guy. Yes, I didn't see it. I'm sorry.
Okay, next.
Next, Charlie,
come on up.
All right. You guys meet up. All right. That's my turn, huh?
4 minutes, Charlie.
All right, let's thank our speakers again. Really appreciate it, guys. Got to come again.
And then, Charlie,
six
or what?
Months or so when it isn't the last game of the World Series. Here, open invitation is extended to come again. I'll be eclectic as usual here. In your presentation there, you said libertarians are for the Second Amendment.
What?
Gun ownership. Well, I have a loony neighbor. My loony neighbor owns weapons. And on occasion, my cat escapes. in the middle of the night, and I'd like to go out and retrieve him. But I'm fearful, because my loony neighbor has weapons, and he also allows his loony offspring access to those weapons. And I'm fearful he may shoot me as some sort of intruder. And the Chinese guy on the other side, his cat, once in a while, gets out, and I gotta go chase his cat, too. So, the thing is, you're talking there a lot about rights. But when it comes to the Second Amendment, does that, my loony neighbor's right to personal safety and owning a gun, is that more important than the public safety of the community? I heard a lot about personal rights.
What does the Second Amendment say?
Does the public safety of the community more important than the personal safety of the individuals comprising it? I'll leave that open to you guys. Now, you hear a lot of things here about retirement. And we're going to cut this there, and we're going to have individual retirement accounts. That's a lot of hooey. 1 or 10% of the people of the United States own 99% of the wealth. And one of the things on your screen, I'd like to know if it's true or false, but is it appropriate, according to your doctrine, to take from the rich and give to the poor? I say absolutely, essentially. And any system that authorizes inequality of this nature has got inherent flaws. Those individuals who accrued that wealth, those CEOs who are providing for their own retirement, do not have attributes that you or I or anyone in this room is lacking. They do not have superior attributes or skills that you or I are lacking. And we have to provide for everyone in that we are in a community, a society, a culture. It's not every man for himself. Those are in desperate situations where the fabric of society is torn apart in emergency situations. But that's fun. Okay.
1 minute left.
Oh, let's see here. The only other thing about the candidate for governor, I really haven't researched the guy, but I do know that Johnson has been there, spent a lot of time in New Mexico, even at the Capitol there. He vetoed 1,000 pieces of legislation. I just find that inconceivable. That's not administrative responsibility. The last thing is, I heard some things there about state rights. States' rights make very little or no sense in today's world where we have telecommunications, and travel. There's no reason for that any longer. It's becoming one world. We're one global society, one nation. And to say that we have to retreat or there's something, that's not going to happen anymore. The world is collapsing and certainly becoming, there's no necessity for these lesser jurisdictions. And the other thing about human rights, and Monday is United Nations Day. They're celebrating the Organization of the United Nations. And if this organization is truly concerned about rights, I would think you've got to find some place in your program or your speeches to discuss the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which are adopted by the United Nations for the people there, and the common standard of achievement for all nations on Earth. That's what we should be striving for, not this list here of pick and choose. Anyhow, thanks a lot. I had a good time, guys.
All right, next.
Thanks, Andy. Thank Andy for putting up with
me. Andy.
Yeah. Oh, you're so poor.
I don't know.
Nine people.
He's got more than
this will be the last rebuttal then.
All right.
And then we'll go to and the speakers will come up.
The speakers
will
get the last words. Okay. Go ahead.
A few quick comments. We're living. We've been living through a concept for some people of the free market, where they're not regulated. They're free to do what they want. They're called billionaire predators. The free market gave us, in this country, we now have the greatest wealth gap between the rich and the poor since the pharaohs walked the earth. The free market gave us Martin Shkreli. an owner of a drug company where he raised the price of one drug from $13 to $750. And he says, I'm sorry that these people are dying because they can't afford the medicine, but I need my billions.
Hey, hey, hey.
The free market recently gave us the company that produces the EpiPen. Raised the price from $20 or $30, what it used to be, to $750 for the same amount. What I see, the libertarian thought does not address billionaire predators. You have to have some sort of regulation to regulate that 4% of a population that has sociopathic or psychopathic tendencies. If you let them amass wealth to the point that they can control a market, and the market's not free anymore, it's free for them, but they control the market and they spread disease, death, and destruction all over the world. The free market gave us one pill a day, 30 pills a month in a bottle for $1,400 a month. It's essentially a sugar pill that they're telling people will prevent their getting infected with HIV. It's a total myth. The top six out of the top 10 most profitable companies on the planet are pharmaceutical companies. Thousands of printed sentences, you know, the tobacco industry said we make it for a penny and sell it for a dollar. The pharmaceutical industry says we make it for a penny and we sell it for $500. That's where we are with free market, unregulated philosophy where they're free to do what they want without regulation. The free market has given us Chevron and British Petroleum, two companies that are polluting the planet and destroying the environment at the rate that they're pushing us toward an extinction level event. That's what they're talking about with global warming and climate change. And anybody that doesn't see the urgency of that is uninformed about the major issues. Last thing I'll say, there's a couple new books out. You want to understand what's happening in our political system? The book Code Red by Jonathan Simon talks about the computerized redshifting of the votes since 2002. We've been told by the media, Censored News describes how the media's job is to maintain us in a bubble of ignorant mythology. We've been told over and over again, Americans are a bunch of dumb sons of bitches that keep voting these criminals into office. Well, we haven't been voting these criminals into office. We've been voting them out, and they've been using the computers with Republican predators running the software and everything else to change the vote totals to keep these criminals in office. And it started in 2002 with the Help America Vote Act when they started putting these computerized voting machines and counting machines around the country. So, I got 30 seconds left. If you can only buy one book a year, buy this one and read it and digest it. It's an annual book. This is the 40th anniversary edition, Censored 2017. Censored News has been up and running for 40 years out of Sonoma State. They teach journalism students how not to get fired and blackballed in America because you can't talk about certain things on television or radio. And what we were, a lot of the things that they talked about tonight are not on television. Incidentally, there's four candidates running for president. There's two that are in the news, and basically two good ones that aren't. Larry Johnson and his running mate are one. Jill Stein from the Green Party is the other one. Either one of those two would be light years ahead of Trump or Hillary. But all of the media is force-feeding us Trump and Hillary. So if the Libertarian Party were able to get decent press coverage, Americans would vote for them in droves. We can change it, like our people said. Mm-hmm. We can change it if we vote, but we have to turn out and vote intelligently. We can't keep allowing ourselves to be sucked in. Vote for the lesser of two rapists. That's what they're telling us this year. This person raped only 100 people in the last 5 years. This person raped only 75. So vote for the one, that's Hillary, that raped only 75. Both of those candidates shouldn't be anywhere near the Oval Office. But that's not in the news.
Okay. Closing remarks from our speakers, please. Go ahead. We got 10 minutes, so closing remarks from our speakers, please.
Good presentation. You guys did a great job.
Again, thank you all for coming out tonight. Appreciate you being here. We appreciate the exchange of ideas. We appreciate the debate. It's very healthy. Obviously, when you talk to someone who doesn't agree with you, it makes you think. But unfortunately, Andy really kind of contradicted himself in his presentation. The last part of it, he was spot on about having more candidates and more choice. And think about the Libertarians and think about the Greens. In the first part, he talked about the open market giving you only one choice for the EpiPen and the other pharmaceutical item. An open market doesn't do that. Government restrictions do. Put open to competition, you wouldn't have just one company making those things. You'd have all kinds of companies doing it. So, I was in California recently for my niece's wedding. And I'll admit, I'm somewhat of a Luddite, but fortunately, my daughter went with me, and she's a technical whiz. And we went from place to place using Uber, which was considerably better and considerably cheaper than traditional cab companies. We stayed at a place through Airbnb, which was less than half of what renting two hotel rooms would have been for three nights. So there is nothing wrong with the free market, and there's nothing wrong with competition. And finally, let me just say, basically, to the people of the country, congratulations. You basically elected, now over 99% of you have put the representatives in office who have been here for the last 50 years, who have given us a $19 trillion debt, endless wars, loss of personal freedom, a Social Security system that's a total mess, and a Medicare system that's a total mess. So good job, guys. Keep voting in the Democrats and the Republicans. You're just going to get the same shit that you've been getting. And my apologies, but that's what you're going to get. There's no difference between Tammy Duckworth and Mark Kirk. There's no difference between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. So just something to think about. But again, it was great to be here. I really enjoyed the exchange of ideas, and I enjoy you coming out to listen to us tonight. And have a safe trip home.
Next speaker, please.
Thank you. Good one.
Thank you very much, everybody.
It's off, so just shout.
So any of my friends who know me says I'm a fanatic when it comes to discussing politics. They usually just tell me to shut my mouth. Somebody asked before, I'm gonna share openly my credentials, okay? I don't have any political credentials, okay? I do have business credentials. I am actually a producer of insurance. I have an insurance license. I have a Series 6 and 63 financial license, so I have experience in the financial planning, okay? I also work for a staffing company, which means I find people jobs. I know a little bit about that kind of stuff professionally, okay? For the last 4 years, I've dedicated my life to reading books, everything I can get my hands on. I've read books from the Communist Manifesto from Karl Marx to Sean Hannity books. I've read Ron Paul. I've read all kinds of stuff. I've read all three sides, if you would, okay? Here's what I'm gonna tell you. Libertarianism is not a utopia. It doesn't exist. Utopia does not exist. Philosophies will always change and always evolve according to the times that we live in, okay? It's been said that the Constitution was written 200 years ago and it doesn't apply to today's world. Well, I believe it absolutely does if we would follow it. The problem is we're not following what was written. And if we understand the ideology behind it, you can apply it to almost any situation in today's world. Here's the other thing. Ken, you mentioned that several people have contradicted themselves. I find it funny that some people will say that I'm voting for Trump, but then I'm going to vote Libertarian. Some people will wear a Rand Paul shirt and say all this stuff that Rand Paul doesn't believe in. I'm not personally attacking anybody, but in a debate where we have ideas, it's pretty funny to me that most people I find are really confused for what they stand on. Okay, I know what I believe in. Okay, I believe in principles. Okay, I believe that if you have applied principles, not just theories, not just conjecture, then principles are ones that matter. Okay. The seven words of libertarianism, don't hurt me, don't take my stuff. You talking about companies that are taking advantage of predator billionaires? Well, there are laws in place where predator billionaires will not affect you, okay? Don't hurt me, Don't take my stuff. Libertarianism absolves that. Everybody has a right to life, liberty, and property all across the board. That means that prosperity is diverted among everybody, okay? The people who are sick, they have help. Back in the day, before the government got involved with this stuff, there was all kinds of different, they called them mutual accounts. Mutual aid societies. Yes, exactly. So societies took care of each other, both on the health care and the financial thing. Libertarianism is an idea, it's not a utopia. There are not one answer solves all. And I welcome the discussion. I think we need definitely more of it. And I'm going to turn the time over to Matt. Thank you very much.
Right. Our final speaker.
Well, I too would like to thank all of you this evening. I thoroughly enjoyed myself here tonight. I know that we didn't agree on everything. And I stood up here as a libertarian, and the truth is I'm just a man, and I'm learning, and I'm very aware of cognitive dissonance, and I try to be the eternal student and to keep my mind open. And I hope that I've given you something, because you've certainly given me something. And regardless of whether we disagree, I'm going to quote Thomas Jefferson and say, I have never found a difference in politics, in philosophy, or religion as cause for withdrawing from a friend. You've all made me a better person this evening, and I really do appreciate the opportunity. Thank you all.
Okay. Close us out.
Sorry?
Close us out.
How do I do that, sir?
Just say, meeting adjourned.
Meeting adjourned.
All right. Hey.